Yeah, so I want to thank you very much for organizing this conference and for inviting me to be part of the one of the presenters in this conference. So I am Hannah Bockarie, the director for Community and Arts Foundation Sierra Leone, and I work an organization that works with women and girls and men in promoting peace and security, helping women to create a space and also providing shelter for abused girls and helping them to cope with their trauma. So I would like to start with an illustration my father used to teach me. I came from a family of 22 children with seven wives. My father was a paramount chief and he usually brings us together to share what is about leadership, what it means to work together as a family, and together we can be stronger. So he has this illustration of matches box and he asks us to break this matches stick one after the other. And then later on, he will ask, put together and ask us individually to break it together. You find out that you find it very difficult. And he will ask all of us to join hands to break it together. And together we did it. So he just like illustrates how important for us to work together as women, as men, working together to promote peace in our locations or in our community. There's unity, there's strength in unity, and we become stronger when we are together. So he always was reminding me of this when I look back. And so my presentation today is gonna be like in two parts. One is gonna focus on a woman in a journey, or me being in a journey of a woman leading. And then the other part, we talk about women in leadership. And I'm gonna use my practical example as a leader, as a woman leading an institution, leading an organization, leading my community, leading my district that I'm staying. And what are the challenges? What does it mean to me? What does it mean to be a woman leader in my context? So like I said, as a woman, one of the things that I've seen in life as I lead through this journey, I always try to use the media. I always try to reach out to the unreached by using my voice in the different media platforms. I grew up in that way, and I grew up in a nation that do not encourage women to be leaders. I grew up in a country, Sierra Leone, where gender-based violence is like a pandemic, and a lot of people suffer from there. We have the 11 years war, we have the issue of the Ebola, we have the corona at the moment, we have the mosque life. So a lot of women suffered a lot as a result of all this pain that the country has gone through. And women are not encouraged in our community to be leaders, and they are not encouraged to take leadership role in the context which I live. So as a Sierra Leonean woman, I grew up in this context, but one of the things I see for myself and I start doing was that I never gave up using my voice. I never gave up, you know, standing there and saying things that are right. I never gave up in meetings and using my voice to say what is there and what does it mean. So we have experienced, as women in this country, we have experienced a lot of violence and during the war, even after the war, we have experienced the issue of poverty. We are experiencing up to now, since decades of years, we have been experiencing a lot of abuse among women and girls for decades. And up to now is the same. So as a woman social worker at the time, I have not been the director. I used to work under the leadership of men, all men who do not really understand what it means to be a woman and who want to lead as well, who do not understand that I wanted to speak up. So for years, I served different organizations under the leadership of men in the different organizations that I work, and men who do not encourage men to speak up and be heard. I was not having any role model, but I so move on. I start connecting with other women. Even as I have the leadership of my leadership are all men, but I start connecting with other like-minded women, like-minded community women and others, that we can connect together and be a network and support each other in the move. So I move. And so this is, I started engaging women in different location, community women, providing the needs that are there, listening to them and sharing my challenges to them, sharing their own pain with me. And I start empowering these women to reclaim their world, to reclaim the land, to reclaim their communities, which they live. And together we start moving on. So I started building this journey in my society to be free of abuse, to be free of gender-based violence, to be free to create a space for all women and children that are suffering. As a woman leader, I start creating this space. I start empowering other women to see the need to stand up and use their voice, and also create a safe place for women and children. In my journey, I have learned a lot. I have learned that leadership cannot improve unless we challenge the power of imbalances. For my context, I never kept quiet, but I start working with other men, working side by side with men, and pointing to the imbalances of the power that they are having. And not only that, also making sure that they ensure that we have access to participate. So I created a space for myself in meetings where people shut me down. I stand there and then I use my voice, and I know I have something to offer to the table. So I never gave up. I promote a lot of dignity among all, and then consider the do no harm policy as well, encouraging men to be side by side with women, promote justice and accountability, demonstrate it as well. So I improve on all of this, and I work with these men who I was under their leadership. And today, the organization that I'm leading, we work with women, work with teachers, work with children, using the prosocial approach in different groups. And we lead the global Ebola that break out in our country and the corona crisis. We have a shelter that we provide for abused girls and women and teenage mothers. They have access to medical, they have access to psychosocial support, they have access to legal aid. As a result of me not being relentless and continue to pursue my dream to be leader of my context, of my community. And as a result of me not giving up as a woman leader, now I can say I am able to influence presidents. I talk to presidents of my nation. I have engagement with the government ministers. I have engagement with church officials and different professionals, even organizational heads. And I believe it's because as a woman, I never gave up. I continue to use my voice. I continue to notice that I have something to offer to the table, or I have something to offer to the economic growth of my country. So as a woman, I raise different professionals, different children and even women using the prosocial approach. And we never gave up. I went to different communities, empowering women to rise up for positions that are in their community. And I even conduct workshops, trainings for women. And in all of our work, we are also considering the men very much. And today we have a team about the organization. We have a team of 50 staff, and we have men and women working together to promote peace and to promote a society that is violence-free. So Commit and Act organization is an organization that works for women and children and even the nation. And after the war, it was founded in 2013. And today, the story continues. as an organization. And I'm grateful to have a friend who started with me in the midst of my incapability, in the midst of my limitation in my journey as a woman leading this cause. And so Beate Elbert, a lady from Germany, was a person that helped me out, and she was really there for me to listen to me, and we have similar stories. And today we have international team of different practitioners, different professionals in different countries. We have Thomas Zabu, we have Georgiana in the UK. Thomas Zabu is a founder of an approach we call Dare to Connect, which we are using in Sierra Leone to help couples that are in crisis. We have Beate at the center here, and we have Ruben in the US, and we have Jennifer Nadozi. These are all women and men that have supported us this far, that we are all working together to help this traumatic nation to recover. Like I said, the other part of the training will be on my leadership as a woman and women in leadership. What does that mean to us? A leader should be able to inspire others to dream more, to learn more, to do more, and become more. And then you consider yourself leading. I like this quote from John Quincy Adams, the sixth US president. Imagine a leader. Is she a woman? Of course, yes. We can. It. So leaders, the behavior and works. So this is what I practice a lot, helping others to guide them, helping others to have the ability, to see the ability in them, to tap into that, to work towards a specific goal and accomplish it. And so I continue to do it in my own way, in my community. I did not stand there to say, oh, because I'm shut down by men, I will not continue. But I continue to empower people to see the common goal and common purpose, and empower them to work towards that values, to work towards what matters to them. But the problem there is, as most of the time, we women are having, we receive a lot of conflicting statements, confusing statements. In my context, I remember when there was this outbreak of Ebola, and there was a case in the isolation center this patient needed to be tested for Ebola. And the guy said, nobody's gonna take my blood sample. And in this EOC meeting, it's a meeting of different organizational heads, professional health workers, and we were together, and nobody knew what to do because the situation was very bad. The guy was really threatened everybody. This patient was threatening every medical practitioner. And I stood there and said, I can offer a session for this guy. I can listen more to this guy if you give me the space. It was a meeting that people do not want to hear me talk. But I said it there. I stood up and said, I have something to offer. And today, at the end of the day, they allowed me to wear my PPE and talk to the guy, and the guy gave consent right there to take his blood sample. So your limitation, the conflicting statement, the confusing advice normally will not help you to go towards what matters to you. In leadership, you should have your focus. You should be able to focus and be able to work towards what matters in the uncomfortable behaviors that you are faced with. That should not stop you. In a society where men dominate the top position and women are taught to seek reflection or to be on the side, to be at the backyard, was the problem that I was faced with as well. There was a lot that was happening. There was a lot that was going on, but yet I did not give up. I continue to serve the people. I continue to be the leader I want to be. I continue to work towards my value. And so I move on. I have different conversations with different categories of people. Different categories of people, and I never gave up, and I continue to have the engagement that is required for what I am doing. So I have the confidence. As women, we can become more confident in rising to our goals and be confident to continue pushing on to the goals and continue to dream, to have your dreams. Like any other leadership position, women experience fear, and it's time to talk about how to lead with confidence. One of the things that I see as in leadership, once you have the confidence, you connect to your values and not focus on your fear, you can continue to lead in that capacity. Ensure female leaders have the experiences and resources. Resources available for them will be helpful. As long as you are connected to, you know, you continue to upgrade yourself, you continue to connect yourself to like-minded women or like-minded groups of people, to having workshop, attending and upgrading, and having the degrees and programs, attending programs, you can do it. Because as long as you continue to connect, you can tap into other resources that are available. So we need others in leadership. We need to choose others to be part of us. Women, men, we all need each other. We need a greater influence. We need to take the lead and then continue in the conversation, help others in their own career. We need also to own the process. We own the process of leading. We need to develop our strategies. Create a space to develop our strategies is also very much important as we are leading. Even though there are some challenges along the way when you do all of this, but one of the things that I say is that you tap into opportunities and motivate other women can help you grow in this line. And forming networks, making priority to form networks that can strengthen you when you are down. And you can also like support them by mentoring them, you know, the social norms you can break, and you can share what is there and how you can tap into other resources. We also need as leaders to create a leadership training experience for women. Training programs for women can also help a lot. In helping women to lead, we also need to build their capacity. We need to be part of networks, prosocial teams, develop our careers, develop our vision by working with others. We also need to create the right platforms where they can perform better, where they can contribute, where they can tap into other resources. This is very key for women leading. Many women struggle with networks. I know for sure that happens. But many also believe that by we putting our hands together and joining others to do to work towards the same goal also help us a lot. It's very much good to build our culture where no one is left behind. So networking is very key. So women should lead. I like this photo because this girl was leading. I went to the school, one of the schools that we are supporting, and I saw this girl coming. Every time I'm there, they all run to me to hug me, and I run towards them. And this girl was leading, and why is others are following? she did not lead because she wanted to lead, but she did because they gave her the space to run ahead, and she was able to lead this team to come and welcome me. So empowering women is essential to the health and social development of families, communities, and countries. Empowering women, we always say when you empower a woman, you have empowered a nation. Because that woman, in our context, a woman that is educated and empowered can always bring back to the community, to the family, to the country as a whole. Because when I come back home, I spend time with my children. I do a lot around my children. And I go back to offer to the community. And I can also offer to the country. So empowering men is very essential to the health and social development of families, communities, and country. So when women are living safe, fulfilled, and productive lives, they can reach their full potential. Empowering girls is the key to economic growth, political stability, and social transformation. All of these are very key for us. When you empower women or you empower a girl, it brings about growth, economic growth, political stability, and even social transformation. This helps a lot. I want to thank you all for listening. Do you have questions?
Thank you very much, Hannah. If anyone has any question, they may write them in chat or raise their hand. And in the meanwhile, I would ask you a question. So you work with men in power and with men in general. As a female leader, what actions, responses from men have you found helpful? I'm curious, what works well? How do you prefer for men in your projects to act with you? Do you have any advice?
Yes, thank you very much. For my experience working with men, most of the things that I look for are the helpful comments that I really appreciate. It's when men engage me on issues they want to talk to me about, instead of pulling me down, instead of saying, I cannot make it, I'm not fit to be in that position because I'm a woman. You know, the pulling down syndrome is what is destructive when you are leading as a woman. And also, giving you the respect. Some men will not respect you because you are a woman. When you want to talk, they shut you down. I got through a lot of that in the initial stage when we started the organization in 2013. People shut me down just because I'm a woman in big meetings. I cannot talk a lot. In our context, there are some chiefdoms where women should not lead as a paramount chief. A paramount chief is like a king. They don't allow women to be leaders of those particular chiefdoms. So things that will not be helpful for a woman leading is when you pull her down, when you humiliate her, when you disrespect her, when you know she wants to say something, shut her down. This cannot help us. But what helps us is when we get a positive feedback from men supporting us, encouraging us to go further, to go more, and take the steps that are required. This will help us a lot.
Thank you very much, Hannah. Any other question? I think that currently there are none. So thank you very much for presenting. And it's great that we could connect live instead of having a recorded presentation. Now we will have a 1 hour, oh, great to see you. Now we will have a 1 hour pause. And after that, Monika Valentim and Fabian Olas will present their own material. So thank you very much and See you in an hour or so. Oh, there is a question. Luciano is asking how to start similar initiative in different contexts, maybe not totally related to prejudice, but to mental health and toxic cultural practices.
Yeah, thank you very much. From my experience working in different contexts, in the similar way I started the different steps that we took was one, inclusion in any step that I take was very key. You know, leaving no one behind. I included the men, I included the women, I included children, and then did engagements. You know, sometimes I do one-to-one engagement and sometimes I do group engagements. First to scan the location or the community or the districts in which you want to start. So engaging individuals and sharing what is there for you and I mean, what's your vision or your mission, and then also engaging groups to scan and then to have their own view of what you want to do in that particular location is very key. So community engagement is key and involvement as well. And then leaving no one behind. Even though I realized that men, they are very much humiliating to me, I never gave up, but I continue to look at them that we need to work side by side. It is not just about me. It's not just about being a woman, but we all need each other. They need me and I need them. And we all need to work together so we can create a safe place for everybody. So that is what we did.
There is a question from Mara. Beautiful and very important work. And how do you work with ACT? Because there are things that cannot be accepted, such as abuse.
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. And Mara, I started working with ACT or using ACT in 2014 when Beate Elbert, a psychologist from Germany, came to do ACT training. And you know, Sierra Leone is a country that has suffered a lot of trauma as a result of the 11 years war. And so we tried to use the metaphors that we learned and then adapt it to our culture, our own local metaphors. That's one way we do it. And we also do a lot of trainings using ACT with different professionals like the stakeholder, the interreligious council members and the community members. And we also ask them to give their own local metaphors that they want to use for their personal life. And one of the tools that we used was the matrix. Matrix was a very adaptable tool for our context that people were able to really work with very good and using the metaphors and looking at the local metaphors that we have that we adapt it to our own language and culture. That's really good. So that's how we use ACT and it has helped a lot of people today in our context. ACT and the prosocial approach was really, and is very much applicable for our context. Hello.
I'm just staying here waiting if somebody's having another question. So just let's give a minute or two for some people to write and we'll see if something appears. And in the meanwhile, maybe could you tell us more about adapting ACT to your cultural context, because I'm curious about the differences that you see or that you needed to, what you needed to adapt. Could you give us a few examples?
Yeah, so like I said earlier on, some of the things that we adapt were the metaphors. And then we also use the matrix a lot that we adapt to our context. And we are people, we are able to identify the pain they've gone through, what they have done around it, and the value behind that, and what they want to do differently. So it was a tool that was very much helpful for our people, especially when they have gone through their history related to the trauma they've gone through as a country. So art was one of the best tools that we use to reach out to our people, and we use the different metaphors, the hands-on exercise, the boss metaphor. But one of the things that was really good was that we tried our best to interpret it to our language, local languages, and also empowering people to at least set it up in their own culture, in their own dialects, so it can be very much workable for them. That was what we did. And we also tried to work with different categories of people. You know, when we have workshops, we have men, we have women, we have even children in these workshops that we are having. And we reach out to many, many people in different locations with our method, the arts approach.